Hey guys, and welcome back to More English with Dry. Today, we are taking a look at An Inspector Calls, and specifically the playwright J.B. Priestley's theories of time that led him to create the play in the way that he did. So firstly, we are going to talk about something called precognition. Priestley developed a fascination with this, and it is dreams or other visions of the future. Cognition, from the Latin, meaning to think, and then pre, of course, meaning something happening beforehand. He looked constantly for real-life examples of something he called future-influencing present, where ordinary people described how they had seen things somehow before they actually took place. In terms of literary modernism, the artistic movement called modernism was very popular in the early 20th century. Modernists were writing in reaction to the new world that had been created by industry and consumerism, one that many felt had destroyed older, better, and perhaps more traditional ways of life. Writers like Virginia Woolf famously tried to experiment by showing the passage of time in their novels and plays in different ways, that is, different to the linear, one after the other way we are used to seeing time unfold in texts. Their purpose was to show that we are still in control of time and our own destiny. Priestley was most influenced by the writing of J.W. Dunn after reading his novel An Experiment with Time in 1927. Dunn argued that only our physical selves are stuck in the present moment and have to obey the rules of time, i.e. we will eventually get old and die. But in dreams, we have a second consciousness that goes between the past, present, and most importantly, the future. He said, we see the future in dreams because in sleep we are free to travel there and experience it. Now this links to Priestley's criticism of England in 1945, when of course An Inspector Calls was written. He was known for critiquing what the country had become. This was something he called Little Englandism. However, it was not dislike of outsiders or modernity, but rather a dislike of big Englanders who wanted to go and boss everybody about all over the world. He saw the evils developing around the world like fascism and commercialism, and felt this was a threat to natural independence and organic community of England. He wanted the nation to wake up and take active part in the sustainment of the glowing tradition of the English spirit. Problems that Priestley felt were encountered in England at this time were rooted in time. He felt that the world had moved to a mechanised age and there was a dominance of the present. What that means is people focusing on what is going on in the exact moment around them rather than thinking about the future. You could argue that in the modern world, things like focusing on technological advancements rather than the environment is such a thing. People had too fully moved away from the past, but also gave no consideration to the future. In his journey all over England, he saw countless examples of cruelty and mistreatment that confirmed his theories. 1945 was a unique point in history. It's the first time where people started to become truly nostalgic for the past. Nostalgia is when you remember something fondly and forget about things about it that were perhaps negative. The untold evils of the world wars, along with the frightening and rapid technological advances, had the effect of making time seem like it was going too fast. People began to wish to go back to a simpler time. 50 years ago, man wanted to cut himself free from all bonds of the past and walk boldly into the modern age. But now, he no longer walks, he is being taken on a machine ride faster and faster. This quotation from George Kernodle really sums up this point we are trying to convey. The American playwright Tennessee Williams, an author of A Streetcar Named Desire, asked the same questions of the world in the 50s. His plays were dedicated to dramatizing miseries of a time-haunted modernity. That is, a world that is constantly plagued by nightmarish thoughts of the past that they wish they could go back to. They concern the dream of a better past and the obsession with returning to it. However, the characters are never able to and are tormented by this. Priestley blamed the inexorable passing of time for the rise of fascism across Europe. Of course, fascism was what led to people like Adolf Hitler taking charge of nation states. Priestley famously wrote, "When masses of men, feeling anything but positive, come to the belief that life is a meaningless accident, then they are soon trapped within a vicious circle. Power is unchallenged, the slave mentality grows, the natural rhythm of work is sacrificed to the machine tempo. The dehumanizing process succeeds everywhere. The satisfying patterns of living are broken, and men in the mass, feeling that they have been let down and cheated, burn with resentments that may result finally in mob cruelty. Above all, modern man is haunted by the idea of inexorable passing time. So how did this affect the way that Priestley wrote plays? Well, he started to think of something called multiple time. In this, past, present, and future exist all at once. And this is how he began to arrange his plays, specifically An Inspector Calls. The future, he said, could come before the present, its knowledge known to the audience. This structure gives the possibility of redemption to characters through better understanding of time. The future redeems the present moment. Now, this was something he called the triadic structure. There are three observers, he argues, in a play. The tension between the first two become the crucial object of understanding for the third. Observer one is fixed in time, i.e. the present, like the Burlings in An Inspector Calls, and only sees it as a sequence. Observer two is detached from the action, free to think about past, present, and future together. This would be the inspector. This empowers observer three, who is usually the audience, because it can see all of the possibilities. Hence, the audience can learn about what to do in the future from the relationship between observers one and two. I.e., we should be taking our moral message from the play. Going forward, Priestley was alarmed with events going on, but felt that by giving English people a greater sense that they controlled time, a temporal agency, we could call it, that they might be more capable of democracy. He makes Donne's theory of time the basis for public action. Therefore, his desire was not escapism, more a desire to awaken society to the possibility to view the past and future as more accessible and available, so that they may not be constrained and oppressed by the present. Temporal freedom enabled by dramatic experience is key to social responsibility and the truest recognition of a citizen's role in social justice. In An Inspector Calls, the play holds that social justice could become truly possible were England's leading citizens capable of this forethought. They need to be able to understand how consequences link them tightly to each other in ways present concerns of just the here and now may not. He genuinely felt these messages could be learnt in the theatre. He wanted the audience, or third observer, to be able to perceive time as one whole. This will make all the difference when the real inspector calls. I hope you found this video to be helpful. I'm going to be publishing more on Priestley's opinions about time and other more high-level theories of several of the writers in the GCSE for English. Make sure to like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time. End of May.